You are listening to an American Free Press podcast.
Joining me on the line is Chris Paluti from southwestern Pennsylvania. Chris, thanks for joining us today.
Hey, thanks, Dave.
Chris, you are a longtime American Free Press subscriber, and you had contacted the office with a very interesting story about a company that seems is trying to illegally acquire your land, perhaps for the minerals underneath it in the ground. I want to get into that in great detail in a moment, but okay. Before we do, for the benefit of the listeners, can you give them a little bit of background about who you are?
Yes, I'm a landowner in southwestern PA, and I own a small farm. I operate a small beef farm. Owned the property for over 20 years, and it's pretty much my side livelihood and large investment for my future retirement, etc.
So you said you're a beef farmer?
Yes, I have beef cattle.
Okay, how many do you have about?
Oh, it varies from a half a dozen to a dozen, depending on the year and the breeding, and it's not a big operation, but it's something that keeps you busy.
Yeah, I would imagine. It's like having six kids, except they're cows. What do you do exactly with them as far as the everyday stuff?
In the wintertime, it's a little more difficult. You have to feed them hay. But in the summer, they pretty much, you graze and you rotationally graze them. And they pretty much gain weight, and then you can market some, or you can use them for breeding. Or I have a couple that are just strictly I keep for breeding. And that's just a side thing I do. And, I'm an engineer in construction and from my real job, I guess you would want to say.
Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, because I'm not from the rural part of the country, although growing up here in New Jersey,
right.
I lived right next to a farm. Of course, everything was farmland at one time.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the old Farmer Jim, used to come out of the front door there. I guess he didn't notice that there was a pretty busy road out there. And,
right.
And he would come out and, literally right next to our house, come out and go right to this big tree and, open his fly and... Literally, take a leak right there. I grew up with that. It was like
right. Nothing.
It was just like something normal.
Right.
What about cows? Are they unique in the sense that you get to know them? Do they have personalities?
Yeah, they all have a temperament, basically. But I have one I raised from her mother wouldn't take care of her for whatever reason. That happens sometimes. So we had to bottle feed her, and she's kind of like a 1,300-pound dog.
Wow.
So it'll come up to me, and I'll feed her, and she'll let me pet her, and... So, they all have different personalities. Some can be pretty angry, and usually those ones you want to try to sell them off. They can be a problem, but for the most part, they're pretty docile, and they, all they want to do is eat and graze, and that's about it. That's what they do. They
mm-hmm.
gain weight, and they can get up to, if you put a bull in there, you can have a 1,700-pound bull, pretty big animal.
Like a car.
Yeah, all car today, yeah.
Yeah, right, exactly. I want to, for the benefit of the listeners, because I researched the stuff you sent me.
Right.
Let's take a look at actually the players here, if this was like a movie or something or a play.
Mm-hmm.
We've got, of course, you and your wife Amber
right. There
out in southwestern PA. Then we have this company, I guess this is the main player here, Alpha Natural Resources.
Correct, and it's one of their affiliates, the mining company, but that's the parent company, yes. There's actually two mines in the area. One's called Emerald and the other one's called Cumberland Resources.
And then I guess the next major player, really, sadly, and obviously we'll explain that, throughout the program here, but
mm-hmm. The
next player would be the Pennsylvania Department, and this is a joke because of the name. They're absolutely not doing what they're supposed to do, the Department of Environmental Protection, right?
Correct. That's correct.
Yeah. We have another company, Wallace and Panter, and I guess they go and they, at least according to their website, they say they bridge the gap between engineering and ecology by helping developers and project stakeholders create projects that result in the least amount of impact to the environment while
mm-hmm.
achieving their goals. At least that's their stated aim.
Right.
And then, of course, we have some news reports about Alpha Natural Resources being hit with a huge fine. Actually, I think it might be the biggest fine ever.
I believe it is for water-related issues of this nature, yes.
And then finally, we have an organization called Citizens Coal Council.
Mm-hmm.
If you would right now, if you could take a little bit of time and explain to the listeners who they are and how do they fit into this puzzle.
Well, Citizens Coal Council, I wasn't too aware of them up until recently, but I knew they existed for quite some time. And basically, I think they're a group of people in multiple states, not just Pennsylvania, that are looking for basically justice based upon, from what I understand, there's federal laws out there, there's state laws that says you can't dump toxins into streams, you can't damage pristine waterways, And they've been pretty instrumental in, I guess, gathering data and information over the last 6 or 7 years, and very instrumental in having this case brought up against Alpha Resources. So they were very instrumental in, you know, getting this data and information and pursuing this. So, you know, you have these laws that says you have to protect these streams and waterways, and some of these streams in southwestern Pennsylvania are classified, you know, the highest grade streams. I don't know the proper technical terminology for them, but they're as high as grades as you can get in this part of the country, and some of them are being undermined and potentially the future undermined, and some of these streams are being damaged to irreparable states.
Mm-hmm.
They've been very instrumental in trying to bring the information, present it to the governments, and if one government doesn't want to seem to do something, then they'll pursue other avenues, and they pursued through the EPA, and I guess they've had some results.
That's awesome.
That's federal people.
You used a word there, which I guess now that I know it, because I'm not very knowledgeable about this stuff, but you used the word undermined. And of course, undermine means when you undermine somebody, you sabotage them. But when you use the word undermine, is that actually a technical term?
Yeah, basically they use what is called a longwall mining technique down here that extracts high amount or high percentage of the coal. And the coal can, depending on what seam they're in, but usually in this part of the country, it's called the Pittsburgh seam. And it can vary from 400 and some feet deep below the surface to over probably 900 feet or somewhere in that range. And they'll go through and take out large panels or large sections of coal. And according to, I believe it's a law called Act 54 in Pennsylvania, that they're allowed to do that. And under virtually any, you know, they can do it under people's houses. They've done it under highways, Interstate 79. And they take out large sections of coal and the ground just subsides below it. In some instances, it can sink 5 or 6 feet. And along that process, what happens is you can, if you undermine streams or creeks or springs, it usually fractures the rock and the water does not show up on the surface anymore. It goes, you know, into deeper areas of the ground, and it becomes pretty much a dry stream or a dry spring, or the water may channel somewhere else. But it usually creates a lot more problems and damages than they've been saying.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, Pennsylvania was really where the whole oil industry began. I wasn't aware of that until I was reading a book about Rockefeller and the trust and all that. Because I never knew that. You would think, well, geez, where did all this oil coming from? And PA, incredible. That state is just rich with oil and coal and, I guess, shale. And now,
that's correct. It's you know, black gold underneath the ground, and it has extreme value to these large companies. You know, they'll pretty much go to any extreme to extract it to make the profits, you know, no matter what, almost.
Yeah, including maybe knocking somebody off.
Well, it's possible. I mean, if you research some people back in the 60s, I think his name was Lebonsky or somebody like that. It was over, I guess, the mining, what do they call them, UA guys and the business agents and that. But anything's possible today, you know, I think. Anyway, that's my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. Hydraulic fracturing, which is shortened to fracking,
right,
is something I guess that's occurring not just in PA but across the country. And it's pretty much proven that it does create earthquakes.
Yeah, I think, I'm not a geologist, but I think there are, depending on the strata and, you know, and how things are in that area where it's at, it's, you know, anything's possible. I think they've proven that in Ohio, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
They haven't really started deep drilling right in my vicinity, but I understand they're moving this way. And if you drive up Interstate 79, Interstate 70, you can see some of these well sites are developing, and you can see the rigs right off the highway.
Wow. Thank you for explaining all this to the listeners here. I think they have a good understanding of what we're going to talk about.
Okay.
Now, I want to start here first with, in some of the documents you sent me here, you spoke of your oil and gas lease transfer. What does that mean exactly?
Well, you can sign a oil and gas lease, and there's many, many avenues and things that you can put in these leases to help protect your interests. At the same time, allow them to possibly extract, you know, natural gas out of the ground. And I had a lease with Chesapeake Energy approximately 5 years ago, and they sold it just last summer to another company. And I had some language in there that they were supposed to notify me in writing and basically get my permission in writing. And they just sold it out and didn't tell anybody. And I found out only on my own because I knew something was up.
Yeah.
And I called up, and they finally told me that what they'd done. So, and I asked, why didn't they get in? Well, we don't know, you know.
Yeah.
Is it illegal? Probably, but by the time you would go to fight it and that, it would probably be expired because it's expiring this year anyway, so.
What is it exactly? What are you signing for?
It's to obtain either free gas or a combination of free gas and or royalty payments. You would get a percentage, and every one of them is different. So, you know, you might get 1/8% one-eighth of royalties, or you might get 15% or 17%. It just depends on your situation, your particular situation.
Okay.
But essentially, I own the oil and gas rights is what it all comes down to, and they're leasing it.
So they're developing it, and then they'll give you a cut of whatever they get if they get it.
Right. And there's no guarantee that it would ever occur, but they're willing to spend that money to sign a lease to get a bonus payment in order to control that interest, because some of this stuff could be worth, you know, literally hundreds of millions of dollars, depending on how many acres you have.
Wow.
And what's underneath there. And they're finding out more and more information that there's, it's, you know, there's black gold down there in a lot of areas. What's happening up in this part of the country is somewhat similar to what happened in Texas, you know, years ago, that these people literally became, there are farmers around here who literally become millionaires in a matter of a few months.
Wow, like the Beverly Hillbillies, I guess.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And some of it's good and some of it's bad. When a fracking thing goes bad, again, I can't speak from personal experience on it, but from what I've heard, that there's ways of doing it and there's some bad companies out there that do some bad things, so.
Hmm. Now, when did you sign the lease originally, approximately?
For what, the oil and gas?
Yeah, the oil and gas.
Yeah, it was almost 5 years ago, so it's due to expire this year.
This issue, though, kind of surfaced last summer, right?
Yes, everything surfaced last summer. Mm-hmm.
You were dealing with a fellow who was representing this company called Geokinetics?
Yeah, and they're basically a company that goes around and does seismic surveying for oil and gas, and they're usually funded by somebody or they work for X amount of companies to develop this information. And then they pay these people to do it, and then they turn that information over to them. So it's the process that they go about to try to find out, hey, where's our hot spots in terms of what, you know, is there liquids under there, or, you know, are there huge amounts of gas reserves, you know, and it gives them a real good idea of where they want to drill and, you know, to what depth they might have to drill. So it's very valuable in terms of oil and gas.
In late June of last year, this fella contacted you, and he wanted you to sign something so they could do what they do, as you just mentioned.
Yeah, and it's basically, they have a carte blanche thing. It says, they can come on and, you know, pretty much we'll do whatever we want. We'll cut trees down. I was like, no, 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 we have conditions. You know, you'll have to follow my conditions under my direction. And sometimes they don't like to hear that, so they will go away, but they might resurface. And they have just recently, and I told them my conditions, and until they're met, you won't be doing anything.
That's cool.
They want to just go in there and, you know, cut trees down or cut roadways. And I said, no, we're not going to do that. We're going to lay it out, and we're going to figure out how to do this thing very non-destructively, and you'll still get your data, and I won't be damaged.
You would think that they would, of course, be amenable to these things that make sense, but...
Well, sometimes they are, I think, but there may be cases where they're not, you know, so I don't know for sure because it hasn't happened yet, but I told him when my conditions are met, then we'll proceed.
Right, but he just disappeared.
Yeah, he disappeared, but now I haven't heard back from him. They'll come back. You know, I think they will anyway.
Mm-hmm.
If that's that valuable to them, they'll come back and try to make some kind of deal. And okay, we'll listen to you. I say, okay, if you listen to me and we put it in writing, then we can proceed.
Mm-hmm. And then you were dealing with this fella from Alpha Natural Resources. I mean, this is in late September of last year. He said to you that, hey, everybody has a price, and you said $5 million. What did he say after you said $5
million? There was no comment. That pretty much broke off any kind of... And then they started all their things with the DEP that they were going to basically a clandestine operation. You know, we're going to put this thing in, we're going to do this. And I said, you know, and that's when all this issue started, the DEP. I was like, well, who said they can do that? You know, they don't control the mineral rights as far as I'm concerned. And you know, they just try to bully you. And I think what they were trying to do is maybe a lot of people don't know what they're up to. So they'll throw a few bucks at them. Maybe they figure, whoa, I'm getting a good deal here, when they're laughing at them. You know, people don't realize they're selling all their mineral rights and everything. They're worth millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And they take advantage of people, particularly people who aren't, you know, well-educated.
Oh,
I happen
yes.
to be a little bit education, you know, engineering degree. And
thank goodness for you and your family that you are. Obviously, the listeners can tell that you know what you're talking about here. Here's one of the parts that really bothered me. Then we get to October of last year,
mm-hmm.
and we're dealing with the, it's funny even saying it, Department of Environmental Protection.
Yeah,
their Bureau of Oil and Gas Southwest Region. I don't quite understand this, Chris. Maybe you could help me out here.
Mm-hmm.
Because here is a taxpayer-funded entity, right?
Correct. Well, I understand it. That's correct.
Right. Their job is obviously to represent the citizens of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
You would think so.
Mm-hmm. And so you spoke to someone named Carol.
Correct.
And you were saying she wasn't very helpful.
Right.
And it sounded like she was nippy. She was saying, well, there's a lot of permits. I would need to know the name. And she also made a smart comment.
Yes.
About you landowners are always looking to get a bigger bang for your buck, even though, as you say here, she didn't even know if you owned any land.
That's correct.
Why do you think it is that somebody who is a state employee, they're funded by you and the other good people of Pennsylvania, why do you think that she feels like she could say this? What do you think motivated her to do something like that?
In her case, I would say that they're probably seeing a lot of people who are becoming, I don't want to say rich, but they're becoming a lot better off in their lives by having some of this gas things going on. Like I said, there are good things and bad things. And probably a lot of these people are just jealous that they, you know, they see people are being, you know, awarded money and they're not getting it. So I think it's probably a jealousy thing in a lot of respect. And there also may be some other things going on there that, you know, I can't really know for sure. But I just think that there's some animosity of some of the things that are going on, and some of the people are being compensated that they will never be able to get that. And they're working some, you know, maybe mundane job that they're making $20 an hour. And I'm not putting anybody down. And that part, I think it's pure speculation, but they were zero help, zero help.
That's something that's disturbing, because you had contacted them many times by telephone and by email.
They're actually two different departments. The oil and gas is one office, and they've actually split them up, I believe. But the oil and gas is one office, and the coal mining DEP are actually two different offices. So I just wanted to clarify that. They all fall under the Department of Environmental Protection.
You had reached out to them several times via telephone, I guess, regular letter and email.
Correct.
And one of the last times was December 2nd of last year. You sent a letter to them telling them that the permit does not address the mineral rights issues with your property.
Correct.
And that Alpha Natural Resources doesn't have your consent that they should deny the permit. And this is disturbing. You had no response to your letter for the whole month of December,
right,
through the holidays and into January.
Correct.
Now, in the middle of January, you and Amber went there.
Correct.
And you paid a visit to DEP.
Right.
And you found out that not one piece of your correspondence in the files, emails, letters, nothing was saved.
That's correct. We found none of our correspondence over this slope issue, whether it be emails, even the letter that was sent from my attorney to their manager of the district, none of it was in the files. I actually pulled out a copy of my letter and said, "Did you ever see this?" And the response from the woman who was supposedly in charge of that permit to review said no. I said, "Well, make another copy of it and make sure that your boss has it." And then I made a comment, "Well, why isn't any of this information in there?" Well, we don't know. Maybe it wasn't just filed yet. And I was like, "Well, I mean, some of this stuff should have been in there 6-8 weeks had gone by." No answer. So there were a lot of good things in there, but one of the local representatives sent a letter and said, "We need these jobs. We have to have coal mining." And the Game Commission sent a letter. They have to send certain letters out to certain agencies if they're going to be possibly affecting them. The Game Commission come back and said, "Well, we had no problems. When I was at a township meeting and I told them, addressed my situation, they never even mentioned it." So it's almost like carte blanche that they just put all the good stuff in there, if there is any, and omit anything that is negative whatsoever, including my issues. And also, I have a neighbor who sent them an email. That wasn't in there either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw that as well. Going back now just to November, when you received this email from this fella, who is he? Is he the manager?
He's, the district manager for that department.
You mentioned his cynical response.
Right.
And I don't quite understand this, Chris. Again, I want to just spend a little time on this. Here's a guy who's a manager for a taxpayer-funded entity, the Department of Environmental Protection.
Right.
And he is sending you this cynical response. And besides that, he's refusing to answer any questions from your wife.
Correct.
And I don't know if this is at the same time here. And this is on that different document that you sent where you were summarizing everything. You say here that he went there with an attorney.
He was on the phone.
A rather worthless attorney, right?
Correct.
And you said that you were looking for some answers. You said, "You're going to answer me." And he said, "I don't have to answer any of your questions."
Correct.
And Amber tried to ask him a question, and he said, "You're done?"
He said, "I'm not answering any of your questions. You're done."
And he started to smirk and laugh?
At my wife.
Okay, now, I asked you before about this lady Carol there over the phone, and I understand that there might be some black gold envy. That's certainly understandable. But what do you think would motivate this manager, this taxpayer-funded manager, to treat citizens like this?
I think he was trying to, again, they don't want you to know exactly what you're doing because there's high value in it. So the longer they can keep you in the dark, the more that they can push their agenda and get things done, and possibly, you know, pull the wool over your eye or scare you into selling your property off at a ballpark price for them. Is he working for me? I don't think so. Is he working for the citizens? I wouldn't think so. I mean, I understand that the laws are supposed to be open for, I know, he's supposed to answer questions, you know, under the Freedom of Information and other laws, and they invited us to a meeting, and I guess it didn't go the way they wanted, so we're not going to tell you anything. I say, that's your right to tell me. I have the right to know. He didn't care. So they have a different agenda, possibly, but I think it's all part of their game, you know. They just don't want you to know what they're doing, you know, and as far as I'm concerned, they're protecting the industry.
Mm-hmm. This is something that has been well documented over the decades, that what happens to these entities such as the EPA or, in your case, the DEP, mm-hmm. that they become captured by the industries that they are ostensibly there to regulate.
I believe so, because, you know, they become too cozy and they're there too long. I know in a lot of private industries, if, you know, they have people, and I won't mention any names, but if they have people that are in purchasing or whatnot, they may move them people around and shuffle them around after a few years because they know that they become cozy with suppliers and vendors. And, you know, I think the same thing that occurs here. The interest is not for me. You know, why am I being punished, you know, by these people who are supposed to be technically working for the public? It's very disturbing, you know, and for these people to basically attack me, it's extremely disturbing.
Yeah, that's why I really didn't understand this guy. I mean, I would think I've held positions that were in the public trust, and I know how I act. I don't like to make any decisions. I like the membership to make all the decisions, and it's their entity, and you can just act as, you know, kind of a figurehead. Here in this case, you would think that this fellow would show you the utmost respect. After all, he is supposed to be working in your best interests, but
right.
It seems like perhaps he's waiting for the opportunity then where he can use what's known as, of course, the revolving door, where they leave the government office and then they revolve into the industry that they were, yeah, ostensibly regulating. And that happens all the time.
This is, yes, it does. Yeah. Yeah.
So let me just ask you about this, because this is chronologically the order of how it happened. Just briefly, you mentioned your neighbor before. This neighbor's lawyer, who he fired,
right.
He called him and left a message on his phone. Let listeners know what he said.
I don't have the exact wording in front of me, but basically he said that, you know, you better take this offer. This is your last offer. You know, if you don't take it, you're throwing good money away. And, you know, when they go to build this slope, they're going to be blasting. They may blast your house apart, so they're going to have to come up there and inspect your house because it could be, you know, blasted apart. My wife actually heard the statement. I told him to save it. I guess he was so mad he erased it.
Right.
I said it may be still on that digital thing somehow, you know, and forensics could probably dig it up. But,
right.
But,
wow.
I mean, you talk about something that's, I mean, who do these people actually work for, you know?
That's what I'm saying. It's almost like the lawyer was also captured by this industry.
And,
yeah, and then, of course, here's, I guess, probably the most disturbing part of the whole thing, if you can look at it individually, an individually disturbing part. On February 19th mm-hmm. of this year, your attorney sent a cease and desist letter to Alpha Natural Resources.
My new attorney.
Your new attorney, right, exactly.
Make clear that.
Right, because your other attorney at that meeting with the DEP, he didn't say...
I let him go immediately.
Right, he didn't say a word.
He had nothing to say. He just sat there like a bump, you know, on the phone. I mean, he should immediately come out and said, listen, my client asked you a question, you answer him. And he never said a word, so... He wasn't working for me. He was working for somebody else. I'm not sure who, but...
Wow. Yeah, this is disheartening. But here's the scary part. And really, Chris, I want you to elaborate on this for the listeners.
Yeah, I will.
You say here that since your attorney sent this letter to Alpha Natural Resources
mm-hmm.
on February 19, 2014, they have had someone parked in a vehicle on the road they cut...
Across the street from my property.
In October, staring straight at your house... And the neighbor's house, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
That's correct.
With their lights on.
They're off and on. Depends on, you know, I guess whether they're sitting in the cold and they want to charge their batteries, but the lights come on, the park lights come on, the regular lights come on, and they shut them off. But they're there 24 hours a day. They had somebody there who was kind of going over the hill and watching some equipment that they had there that was parked all winter. They could have moved that equipment in and out of there probably 10 times for what it cost them to keep somebody there 24 hours a day because they wanted to, he was just sitting there. But they would rather spend money. And here's a company that has financial difficulties, by the way. They would rather pay somebody to sit there and antagonize us and stare at our houses 24 hours a day. So once that letter was sent to them, you know, they were going down over the hill, and then you'd see and they'd come back up. And then they just sat there parked, facing in our place since. And it's still going on as we speak.
Do the lights shine into the house?
No, but they shine onto my property. And sometimes they shine near the house, but it's probably a couple hundred yards away almost, which is a good thing. But they're sitting there, so we have to, you know, close our drapes in the, you know, the bathroom, and pretty creepy, you know.
Yeah, I was going to say, what do you think the ultimate purpose is?
It's an intimidation tactic.
Can you get the law to get the sheriff there to get rid of them, or no?
No, no. We called the state police, and they must be buddies with them, or they must have told them something, that they're guarding something valuable, because they pretty much, he's just a guard, you know.
Yeah.
We might send somebody up, they said.
Yeah, yeah. This part I didn't mention, I wanted to, was that since summer last year, you say that they're trying to scare you into selling by building roads and cutting into a hillside and drilling core holes.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, they're burning trees,
right,
and generating smoke and ashes.
Right.
Yeah, and they even caused a large excavator to catch fire because they were doing it.
They burned up one of our own pieces of equipment. It's probably worth $200,000. I called this guy, their land guy, the day before and told him, you're not allowed to burn. It's dry. You shouldn't be burning. As far as I'm concerned, you're not even allowed to burn. I said, the ashes are blowing my way. It was very dry at that point in time. We had rain all year, but it was dry. Now, fall, sometimes it can get pretty dry around here until we switch into winter. Oh, we're not burning. We'll keep an eye on it. And next thing you know, the next day they burned their excavator up. Fortunately, they didn't hurt anybody or kill anybody. And then the next day I called the fire department. They went over there and looked at it and told them to contain it. And the next day I found out they burned the excavator. OSHA was up there, and I said, I told you guys not to burn. And the guy called me back that night from the coal mine and said, oh, we're sorry. We didn't mean the ashes to come on your property. Now, that's the first time the coal mine ever called me to say some kind of apology. I knew right away that they still need something, you know?
Right,
there's
exactly.
There's something there that they need.
You say here that it appears Alpha Natural Resources will try just about anything to get me to cave to acquire my property, even if it means incarcerating me, framing me for a major crime, or possibly even...
Let me elaborate on that a little bit. After that meeting we had at the DP's on the 31st, about 2 weeks later, I got some papers that said that I was having charges filed against me because I beat him up. I physically struck him, punched him, kicked him, assaulted him, knocked him down, and the police report said all this. You know, so now I had to hire an attorney, okay, to defend this upcoming situation. This is how the state treats me, you know? You know, I've talked to a police friend of mine who's a very good guy, and he said, did the police try to call you and ask you your side of the story? I said, we left the building because the guy ran away. We didn't even know where he went. We left, walked out of the building. He left us in a meeting room, didn't even tell us where he was going. Then we get these charges. The guy's perjuring himself, falsifying police reports. As far as I'm concerned, the whole thing's a total scam. What did this guy gain out of this? Is that what they're trying to do, get rid of me?
That's what I was going to ask you about, because at that meeting, and you were there with Amber, and of course that worthless attorney was on the phone.
Correct.
When you guys pretty much were at the end where he refused to answer any questions and he started to smirk and laugh at Amber, and then Karen McCoy, whoever she was, she left the room.
She had left earlier. You know, when we started getting loud, she left. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then you said, hey, you know, you're messing with my life here, and wiped that smirk off your face.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. Again, he's a public servant. You don't smirk at the people you're there to help.
You wouldn't think so.
No, and then he continued to smirk, and then you say he got up from his chair, and then you had some other words with him.
Yeah, I pretty much called him a rotten, you know, SOB, and you're in a rotten hell for lying, and you shouldn't lie like that. You're going to go to hell.
Right, and he ended up lying some more, which you could have never imagined that he would have done that. But then what was interesting was that you thought, because he moved towards you, and you say that you thought that he might hit you, and then he called for some other...
there was like another guy that came in, he was hollering for somebody, and I don't know if he nicknamed him, but I can't remember, you know, the name. Even my wife can't remember, but this guy never did that. I thought they might try to do something, or this guy grabbed me, or, you know, but that didn't happen. And that guy, he never mentioned his name or anything in the police report, so I'm thinking, why did that guy lie to me? That guy told him, I'm not lying for you. You know, I don't know.
Right. Yeah, that's why I wanted to bring this up, because this is what these false accusations are based on. So he never touched you. You never touched him.
Right. He just brushed past him as he left the room, and hurriedly left the room. And, you know, he didn't go around. He kind of went around the table or that. He went brushed right past me, and away he went.
He actually came into physical contact with
him? Well, he might have brushed my shirt.
Okay.
Know?
Is this guy a big guy or a little
He's
guy?
He's bigger than I am, I can tell you that. I'm 6 foot, 220 pounds.
And him?
Yeah, he's probably 6'2" or 3", you know,
okay.
two something.
Mm-hmm.
When he talk with other guys, her impression was, you know, are they going to jump me?
Yeah.
And it ran through my, it crossed my mind. I'm thinking, you know, hey, look, guy, we can take this outside if you need to, you know, man on man, one on one. But, you know, that didn't happen. And it's a good thing, you know.
Oh, hell yeah.
No matter how mad you get, you know, it's not worth that. And
no.
So this is, you know, I mean, my opinion, it's just another tactic to drain my funds, drain my money, put pressure on you, give up, you know. Hey, just give up, you know. We'll buy you out for a cheap price, you know.
Exactly. Most people do give it up because they really can't stand the pressure.
Oh, it's, imagine someone's trying to force you off of your, you know, I custom built my house. I can't do that anymore. I'm getting too old to do that, even though I'm in good shape.
Right.
This is the last thing we have left in this country is your so-called property.
Exactly.
And if they take that away, you know, then America's going to be like the rest of the rogue third world countries and thugs and dictatorship places. That there'll be nothing left.
Exactly.
We'll fall apart so fast that it'll be mind-boggling.
What's the status of his complaint against you?
Well, you know, there's going to be a hearing shortly. I don't know how it's going to shake out. But...
Incredible.
Yeah, yeah.
Doesn't he have to show that he was actually hit? Does he have photographs of his black
eye?
Well,
that's the whole thing. My attorney's going to, where's the physical damage? Did you go to the hospital? Where's your hospital report? You know, that's like my friend said, the police are supposed to investigate that.
Yeah.
Where's your industry? You know, let me see your black eye. Did you punch yourself in the face? You know.
Wow. Unbelievable. So as we speak right now, there's a car a couple of hundred yards away.
There was, yes. Let me look. They're still there.
Wow. Unbelievable. So what happens now? Where are you at now in the whole process?
We still don't know, but my attorney, he's starting to get pretty upset. He's going to get in touch with their counsel again next week and find out what are they doing. Their time is up. If you don't tell us what they're doing, then he might file some other legal action against them.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have not proven, you know, that they can do what they want to do. They've had 3 months to do it, and they can't do it. So you would think if they had some, they would smear it in your face by now, you know. We're still up in there. We still don't know exactly what they're doing. There's been trucks running up and down the roads for the last few days and hauling gravel and moving dirt, you know, across the road on that piece of property that they owned, that they bought. It was a beautiful farm when I owned this farm. It was beautiful. 200 and some acres of pristine farmland, and now it's probably destined to be turned into an industrial dump.
I've driven through PA plenty of times, and it is just beautiful country. It's idyllic. It's almost like it's not real. You look at these rolling hills.
Rolling hills. It's still rural where I live, but they just keep expanding, you know, all this stuff here. In 20 years, it's going to look ugly. It's damaged, I think.
Yeah.
Irreparable damage.
Irreparable.
Especially the waterways, you know.
That's a shame.
What I've told you are the facts, strictly the facts, the way I know them, the way I see them and envision them. As I said, I'm an engineer, and I deal with the reality and the facts. So that's pretty much the way I see it. And, well, you know, hopefully one way or the other, we'll find out how this thing's going to shake out here shortly. So, you know, it doesn't keep perpetuating.
Mm-hmm. Well, perhaps we can speak again to update the listeners.
Yeah, I think that might be a good idea.
And I want to thank you so much, Chris, for the time you spent explaining all this to the listeners. You're obviously the type of person that built this country up and made it strong, a great American.
I want to thank you, Dave, and thank you for your service and your past service, and thank you for this opportunity.
Oh, of course, anytime.
Hopefully it helps out, you know, other people in the future.
Well, that's the idea, and hopefully it's going to turn out positive for you, and I'm looking forward to speaking to you real soon.
Okay, Dave.